Good morning. Good morning. I'm Rob Satloff. I'm the director of the Washington Institute. I'm really delighted that so many of you would come for a discussion which isn't headline issue, which isn't what's going on in Syria today, what's going on in Iran today, or violence in the West Bank today, but a discussion which is as much history, experience, as it is politics. Welcome to the Washington Institute, and welcome to our new Schreiber Family Conference Center. I'm always delighted to welcome people to our new offices. Like many historians, my eyebrows went up when I heard the comments of Israel's Prime Minister ascribing to the Mufti of Jerusalem responsibility for convincing Hitler to exterminate rather than just expel Jews. Now, I don't know if Prime Minister Netanyahu misspoke, exaggerated, or willfully rewrote history. I do not know if, as some pundits have suggested, I don't know if he was crazy like a fox, purposefully stretching history just so he could plant in people's minds the connection between Palestinians and the Holocaust, and thereby stir a debate that would leave a lasting impression. I can tell you precisely what I wrote a senior Israeli government official hours after these remarks were reported. I wrote, quote, "As the author of a book on Arabs and the Holocaust, I really urge you to have the Prime Minister tone down his focus on the Mufti as the source of Hitler's extermination policy. The Mufti was an evil SOB, but in any operational sense, a fairly marginal actor in the Holocaust. The Nazis didn't need any help from Arabs in figuring out whether and how to kill Jews. And while the Mufti's virulent anti-Jewish ideology has had long-term impact in corners of the Middle East, especially but not solely among Palestinians, it actually had little direct impact on thinking among Arabs at the time, despite the best efforts of Nazi radio and propaganda. There is no benefit," I wrote, "there is no benefit in inviting the critique of serious Holocaust historians who, to be polite, do not universally share the Prime Minister's views on this issue." Now, I thought that this episode would die away very quickly, and I guess in general it has died away. But then I realized that there could be more to the story. Not so much in dissecting the Prime Minister's words, but in perhaps using this episode as a learning moment. The Holocaust is bandied about so much these days as a political metaphor in the Middle East that perhaps, I thought to myself, perhaps it's useful to take the opportunity of the moment to inject some real history and some real firsthand experience into the discussion. History of what roles Arabs really did play in the Holocaust, and firsthand experience of what it means to be an Arab today who wants to learn about what the Holocaust truly was and its meaning in today's political environment. So, nearly a decade ago, I wrote a book about this topic, the roles that Arabs played in the Holocaust, good, bad, and indifferent. And we will see later a few clips from the 2010 PBS documentary that I made with McNeil Lehrer Productions based on that book and subsequent research. I am fortunate, and we're fortunate at the Washington Institute, to have as a partner here my friend Mohammed Dajani, a Palestinian scholar who appreciates the learning, who appreciates the importance of learning what the Holocaust was all about, and who has paid an enormous personal price for that effort. 4 years ago, Mohammed and I wrote an op-ed together that you have before you, Why Palestinians Should Learn About the Holocaust. That op-ed was triggered by a previous episode of the Holocaust emerging as a topical discussion between Israelis and Palestinians. It was triggered by the idea that the Holocaust should appear in a curriculum that was being prepared for schools that UNRWA might consider using, and the blowback among both UNRWA employees and certain other elements in Gaza about the idea that the Holocaust would appear on a human rights and genocide curriculum in general. That was just one of the periodic episodes in which the Holocaust emerges in Israeli-Palestinian arena. There obviously have been more and more recent, and Mohammed is going to tell you about his. Today we have the opportunity to learn about both, to learn about the firsthand experience that Mohammed brings to this issue, and a bit more about the history and the context that I will try to bring to this issue. And when all is said and done, I am in fact going to link all this back to the Al-Aqsa Haram al-Sharif Temple Mount issue that triggered the entire episode. So with that, first let me show you a brief clip from CNN about Mohammed, and then I'm delighted to welcome to the podium the Institute's Weston Fellow, Professor Mohammed Dajani. Oh, actually, Mohammed will speak from here, but wherever you want.
Yeah,
wherever you want.
Okay.
The showdown between Russia and Ukraine demonstrates how hard it is to understand the story of the other. The struggle over narratives dates back at least to the time of the Passover, which begins tonight, when Pharaoh kept the people of Moses in bondage. So now imagine a world where imagining the other could mean deliverance for warring sides such as Israelis and Palestinians. In what may be a first, Mohammed Dajani, a Palestinian professor at the Al-Quds University in East Jerusalem, recently took 27 of his students to Auschwitz, the notorious concentration camp in Poland. The idea was to promote greater understanding between peoples, and yet Professor Dajani was branded by many of his own people as a traitor. He proudly calls himself a Palestinian nationalist, but he's also a fan of the renowned Israeli author Amos Oz, who appeared on this program 4 years ago to talk precisely about understanding the other. He came with a Palestinian lawyer whose son had been killed and who had commissioned an Arabic translation of Oz's work.
First of all, I think to know the other side is something important, whether we want to fight him or whether we want to make peace with him. And knowledge is a light for good and for bad.
So if knowledge is the light, Oz himself also spoke of the importance of translating and understanding the other.
I'm a great believer in literary translations between enemies as a healer, as a method of removing stereotypes and replacing the hatred by more complex, not necessarily by love, but it will improve the ability to imagine the other. And I believe imagining the other is a moral quality.
Meantime, Professor Dajani has defied his critics, saying, quote, "I do not regret for one second what I did. As a matter of fact, I will do it again if given the opportunity. I will not hide, I will not deny, I will not be silent. I will not remain a bystander, even if the victims of suffering I show empathy for are my occupiers." Powerful words indeed.
And just to underscore the fact that Mohammed's critics were not merely those who took to newspapers and airwaves to express their criticism. Mohammed's critics were those who firebombed his car and his family home and who threatened his life for having the temerity to bring Palestinian students and with him to Auschwitz to learn about collective humanity and their common history. Mohammed.
Thank you very much. Let me
hold you. Sure.
Thank you very much for actually coming this morning to attend this session, and thanks, Robert, for having me here. I would like to share with you my personal journey, my personal narrative that actually took me all the way to what you saw. My name is Mohammed Dajani Dawoodi, and Dawoodi is the family name for King David's tomb, because in 1523, Sultan Suleiman appointed our family to be the custodians of the King David tomb. In 1863, when the Ottomans started to make municipalities, the first municipality was in Istanbul, the second municipality was in Jerusalem, and they appointed Mayor Abdurrahman Dajani to be the first mayor of Jerusalem. In 1938, my relative Hassan Sudqi Dajani was assassinated by thugs sent by Hajj Amin al-Husseini because he called for reconciliation and for a bi-national state and for reconciliation with Jews between Jews and Palestinians. And at that time, it was considered treason. He was a man ahead of his time. In 1948, when the conflict started, my grandfather sent us to Egypt, my grandmother, my uncles, my aunts, to live with his brother to be away from the conflict. When we went back after the conflict was over, after the war was over, we found out that we lost everything. This was not the first time that I lose as a person everything, but the spirit of my grandfather was of a different caliber. He was a man of steel. When he came one morning to back home from work, he the one who had lost everything, all his property, his buildings, his money, and started all over again from scratch. He found that his wife has brought from UNRWA a card and some munition, and so he was very upset, took the card, tore it, and said, "I'm not a refugee, and I will not be a refugee." So I thought that idea of not being a refugee, not being down, but rather standing up despite the obstacles was my guiding light. And in 1948, actually, Jewish quarter fell, the Dajani family protected Martin Pupper. And when the Iraqi leader came, they told him that the Dajanis are hiding a Jew. And when he came, actually, they slipped him away, and he found his library. And he wanted to burn it, to take it out and burn it. And they told him, the Dajanis told him that you do not want to be labeled as the one who burned libraries, so he kept it. Buber was lucky that he found people to stand up for his library, but unfortunately, I didn't for three times. In 1975, when I was deported from Lebanon to Syria, actually the Lebanese authority just came to the house and surrounded it and took me in a car. I never felt so important in my life because they had all these arrangements for me to deport me to Syria. They left me at the border and saying, "Go in that direction, Syria is there." I had no passport, I had no money, I had nothing, and I have left my house and library behind me. And so that was the first time I lose my library. Second time I lost my library was when I came to the States. For 10 years, studied an MA and two PhDs in order to remain here for my residency, which actually exactly what I did in Lebanon. I accumulated more than 350 credit hours at the university to just stay there. And then when I left to Jordan, I actually, after King Hussein gave me a pardon to go back to Jordan, I left my library here and couldn't take it with me. I only took a suitcase. That was the second time I lose my library. Third time I lost my library was in 1995 when I went back to Jerusalem. I had a very big library in Jordan, and then the Jordan authorities did not allow me to go back. So I lost the library there. So basically, it is the idea of loss and found. The idea of how to how to be able to move on with your life and leave the past behind. When I was standing at the borders in Lebanon, with nothing, with no passport, with nothing, and just don't know what to do, I thought that was the lowest point in my life. However, it turned out to be for my best. And in the Quran, it says, "I'll buy to my taste something that might turn out to be for your own good." Asan takraw shay'an allahu khayrun lakum. And so that was actually the best thing that happened to me, because it took me out of the cave of ignorance, out of the cave of mythologies, out of the cave of misperceptions, and took me to universities which were so advanced that helped actually develop my thinking, develop the way I behaved, develop the way I wrote, and so in this way, it was a very significant experience for me here in the United States to stay at universities, at the best universities, and to learn from the best teachers. And so I learned about democracy, about culture, about education, about a lot of things that I couldn't learn when I was in Beirut because of the taboos. It was part of the taboos of learning. I never learned about the Holocaust. I never learned about Jews. I never learned about Judaism. I never learned about all the things that matters in my life. And so that's why when I went back in 1995, it was also a very traumatic experience for me, because it was first time I crossed the bridge to go to Jerusalem, and I found a totally different world there. My experience before was in the years I spent in Lebanon were very radical years, and I at that time we believed that Israel is the dagger in the Arab heart, and so imperialism, this is an extension of imperialism in the region, and the only thing that we should do is eliminate Israel so that there will be Arab unity and prosperity. However, any crossing the bridge, I came into two major experiences that changed my life. One was with my father. My father started to take me to Ain Karim Hospital, where he was hospitalized for cancer. And my initial impression was that the doctors, the nurses, that they will treat him as an Arab, as a Palestinian, as a Muslim. But then I was very shocked to find out that they were treating him as a patient, as a human being that needs help. And so I looked around in the hospital and saw many Palestinians also taking, being looked after and being and receiving health care. So that was my first eye-opener. My second experience, which was also very traumatic to me, was that my father died, and a few years later, my mother asked us to take her to Tel Aviv. And it was a Friday afternoon, and so we drove, me, my brother, her, and my niece to Tel Aviv. We had dinner, and suddenly she had an asthma attack. She had in her bag, there were three empty inhalers, and so we thought, we didn't really appreciate the moment. We thought that we can drive back, we can drive her back to Jerusalem. However, in the car there was the heart attack, the asthma turned into a heart attack, and then we were coming to the exit of the Ben Gurion Airport, and the question was whether to take that exit and or to continue to Jerusalem. And my brother was driving against my judgment, decided to take her to the airport to seek help. Once we got to the gates, the soldiers, and we told the soldiers we had a patient, they immediately vacated the area, and they brought ambulances to help her. And there in front of me, there was my enemy helping my mother. And so to me, it was very significant. And for an hour, they tried to resuscitate her. And then they found a pulse. They decided to take her to the nearby hospital, which was a military hospital. Yet they asked for permission, and they got that permission. However, when we got there, they kept us waiting. And then after more than an hour, a doctor came and said, sorry, but your mother died on arrival. So our reaction was, why nobody told us? And his reaction was, because we were afraid of your reaction. So basically, and we thanked him. We left her there because it was Shabbat and we couldn't take her back. And driving back, I was looking at her empty chair and thinking that in the morning nothing was there, and thinking of her loss, but at the same time thinking of my enemy who tried to help my mother. So basically, I thought that the good in the other, even if it's an enemy, then it brings the good in you. And in this way, I shifted from being from us to us or them, or from there is no place for the other, this is my land, my country, and to us and them. And so in this way, it was a significant change in my life. And I actually looked at the Palestinian society and saw that there are taboos within the society. And the first taboo was the way they looked to the Americans. They looked at Americans and they did not see the culture, the history, they only saw the politics. So their line was, their motto was, the friend of my enemy is my enemy. And so I tried to shift that in order to build bridges by establishing the American Studies program at Al-Quds University. The second taboo that I noticed was this hatred for the other. And in this way, the extremism of anti-Jewish, anti-Zionism, which borders on anti-Semitism. And so in this way, I started a movement called the Wasatia movement. And it was inspired by actually an experience that I watched, where I was standing on the balcony of my house on a Friday morning in 2006 after Hamas was elected. And then there were these people who were rushing in the morning and on a Friday morning to go to Jerusalem to pray and to the Haram. And the soldiers were pushing them back because they didn't have permits. And there were hundreds of them. And the soldiers were throwing tear gas at them and trying to push them back. And I thought that these are Hamas people, and they are not going to pray. They are going to just make an issue. And suddenly I noticed that things cooled down and realized that there was a deal made by the officers at the checkpoint in which they took the Palestinians in buses after surrendering their IDs. The buses took them to Jerusalem to pray. The buses brought them back. They got their IDs and went home. So to me, it was a win-win situation. In that sense, the Israelis worried about security. The Palestinians wanted to pray. And so I thought that this is not Hamas. These are not radicals. They are moderate. The question was, who represents them? And that's how we started a movement I called Wasatiyah, which is from the Quran, verse 143 of Al-Baqarah Surah, وَكَذَلِكْ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا, which says, and thus we have created you a moderate nation. And the verse is verse 143, and the surah has 286. So 143 comes exactly in the middle. And so that's the symbolism there. And then the third taboo that was there was the attitude towards the Holocaust. And so that's why in 2011, for the first time, I encountered the Holocaust when a French organization called Alaeddin actually invited more than 150 religious leaders in February 2011 to go to Auschwitz. And I was among the people who went, and actually I took with me the deputy of the Ministry of Religious Affairs and the Palestinian Authority. And we went to explore, to see, to learn, And it was February, and it was extremely cold, extremely, and this it was snow, and so, and maybe the organizers made it a point to show how people were living in these conditions, without fire, without heating, without, and so it was a very important learning experience for me, and the question on my mind kept: why is it that we don't learn about the Holocaust? Why is it that we deny the Holocaust? Why is it? How does the Holocaust impact our narrative? And so, when I went back, and then Rob asked to, and we wrote a joint article that is on here. Why should Palestinians learn about the Holocaust? Palestinian reaction actually was among the intellectuals, because the article was not translated to Arabic, so not many people read it. But the reaction was said to me, why didn't you write why the Israelis should learn about the Nakba? So this connection between the Nakba and the Holocaust kept coming up all the time. And that's why when we went to Auschwitz, when we took the students to Auschwitz, the experience of the student was that they saw the Auschwitz, some of them saw Auschwitz from the small perspective, in the sense from this myopic perspective of comparing guards to to Israeli guards, or posts, or barbed wires, and then looking at the Holocaust from that perspective of the Palestinian suffering and this comparison. They missed the point that the Jews see the Holocaust as a termination of a people, of a culture, of a religion, of so it is in the broad sense. So that's what was the message we wanted to try to show them, to tell them, to teach them, that the Holocaust is not about the barbed wire. It's about that you cannot compare between your Nakba and their Holocaust, because they are totally different in objectives, in meaning, in significance, in magnitude. And in this way, and don't keep this comparison, because it is a dark alley that you take. And many of them, it was a very important learning experience. And one of the girls who saw the sign on the entrance, and it's which said that work will set you free. And then she asked about it, did work set anybody free? And then she went and bought a book that commander of the Auschwitz was said, quoted to have said, that all you have in welcoming newcomers, saying all of you who come here forget hope, or because the only way you will get out of here is through the smoke and the chimneys of the crematorium. So to her, who she was 9 years in Israeli prisons, yet to her, this was a traumatic learning experience, because in the beginning, the first visit, in the beginning of the visit, she was comparing herself as a prisoner to what she was saying. But eventually, she realized that it is that she is alive, she is there, and yet it is a totally different experience. And in this way, other students who thought that Hitler gathered the Jews to send them to Palestine realized that this was not the case. So it was, to them, it was an eye-opener. Unfortunately, when we went back, there was all this uproar regarding the trip, and I believe it was more instigated. One of the students asked me later, what was more painful to you, the fact that you lost your job, or the fact that you were labeled as a traitor? And I said neither. What was most painful to me was nobody stood up for me. among the Palestinian faculties to say this is academic freedom, or to say that not in my name, or not to be a bystander, by just at least posting one post on the on Facebook to say that, or on the university website to say he did not do anything wrong. And this was the argument between me and the president of the university when I submitted my resignation. So he asked to me, he asked for a meeting, and then he asked, why did you resign? I said, because I looked around and nobody is supporting what I did, and nobody is saying that this is academic freedom. He said, yes, it is academic freedom, and you did not anything wrong. However, he said, I received phone calls, and I met people who said that your life is in danger. I will give you security on campus, but when you are outside campus, I cannot provide that security. And I told him, I don't want that security. What I want from you is a statement saying that I did not do anything wrong, that this is academic freedom, and this is about education, and that you encourage this step towards education. But unfortunately, instead of doing that, he accepted my resignation, giving the signal that they support the uproar rather than they support academic freedom. So basically, I think we made a crack in the wall, and that was extremely important. Before I finish, I'd like just to make a few points. I don't know how much time do I have, but I would like to, and people ask me what keeps you optimistic about the peace process, and my response is you are thinking in terms of the past and the present, and I'm focusing on the future. Because I learned when I was in the first grade, I learned the story of this king who was walking through the fields, and he met this old man planting an olive tree. And the king wanted to tease him, and so he said, old man, do you expect to benefit from the fruits, from the olives, from this tree? They will take more than 20 years. Do you expect to live that long? And the old man said, we planted, our grandparents planted, we ate, we plant so that our children will eat. We, as a generation, have actually inherited this conflict. So it is so important for us to leave for our children a peace inheritance rather than a conflict inheritance. And this is what we are doing. We are seeking and in trying to seek for reconciliation in midst of conflict. The idea is moderation leads to reconciliation. Reconciliation paves the way for negotiations in good spirit and goodwill, which leads to conflict resolution, and then this will lead to democracy and prosperity. So basically, what we need is to learn about each other. We need to read the stories of the other. We need to put ourselves, this clashing narratives that we have, we need to resolve this by bridging our clashing narratives, one, by putting ourselves in the shoes of the other and walking in it, and second, by trying to be critical to our narrative, to look at our own narrative and try to be critical of that narrative, and third, to try to seek the truth in that sense. And so it is so important to be able to do that. I want to finish by pointing out some of the points, that the Holocaust is the tragedy of the Jewish people, but also it is the tragedy of humanity. It is not a Jewish concern only, but a human concern. So it is in demonizing and blaming the other tends to a dead end. So it is so important to heal wounds and move on with our lives. Looking at the Palestinian, linking the Holocaust to the Nakba does not help, and on the contrary, it is part of the problem rather than part of the solution. And so I'd like to end with two verses, one from the Judaism and the other from the Quran. The first one says, "Thus said the Lord of hosts, there are the things you are to do, speak the truth to one another, render true and perfect justice in your gates, and do not contrive evil against one another, and do not lover perjury, because all those are things that I hate." From the Quran, "Let there arise from among you a community who would invite to righteousness, enjoy doing what is right, and forbid evil. Such are the ones who shall be successful, who shall be successful." That's why what we try to do is try to do good, and it is not whether it's a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew, but it is whether we are human and doing good. And that's to do the right thing and not to be a bystander is doing the right thing. Yesterday, actually, I was very glad to read in the Washington Post the story about the two doctors, one an Arab doctor and one a Jewish doctor, Jews and Arabs healing the injured. And so it was talking about these two doctors who are in the Hadassah Hospital trying to heal the injured from both parties. And I think that's the spirit that we should have for the future. Thank you very much for coming.
That is what's called a tough act to follow. 2 weeks ago, I moderated a forum here on Israeli-Palestinian violence and terrorism, and I showed everybody a copy of the 1924 pamphlet by the Supreme Muslim Council, then headed by Hajj Amin al-Husseini, which stated that Al-Aqsa was, in fact, built right on top of the site of Solomon's Temple, and that this fact was, quote, beyond dispute. Now, we know, of course, that today many Palestinian political figures do dispute what was then beyond dispute. My point was not to highlight the cynicism of contemporary leaders, even though that may be true. My point was to underscore the fact that the way things are and the way things are understood to be is not the way they always were. Yes, Jews, Muslims, and Christians have disagreed and even fought over Jerusalem for hundreds of years, thousands of years. But it is only recently that they disagreed about the history of what they're fighting over. It reflects a political dispute, not a millennial dispute about religion, about God, or faith. It is a political dispute. And so, too, with the question of the role of Arabs in the Holocaust. Yes, real flesh and blood Arabs, not just the almost cartoonish character that Hajj Amin has emerged to become in popular imagination. Just as an aside, I asked my excellent research assistant, Marina Shalaby, in the last couple of days to do a little experiment trying to check where Hajj Amin fits in what I'll call a public discourse or a public acceptance in Palestinian society today. Now, how do you measure this? So I asked her to check how many public memorials, statues, streets, camps, libraries, these sorts of things there are to Hajj Amin, and to put it in some measure of comparison with other major Palestinian figures. And it's, I think, very illustrative. It's not to say that Hajj Amin is irrelevant, because he isn't. He's actually quite relevant in certain sectors of Palestinian society. But in terms of sort of public memorial, you know, obviously you have Yasser Arafat way up top. Then you have someone like Dalia Mughribi, famous terrorist of the Coastal Road Massacre. Three times as many public memorials as Hajj Amin. Who does Hajj Amin equate to in the sort of level of public memorial? Ironically, someone like Issam Sartawi, the Palestinian who was assassinated by more radical, I think it was then Abu Nidal, for expressing the idea of coexistence. Very ironic that there's only two. I mean, we might be off by one or two, but the order of magnitude is correct. Only two sort of public memorials to Hajj Amin, two public memorials to Issam Sartawi. It's a very interesting way to gauge the level of public reverence for these characters. Now, getting back to Arabs and the Holocaust, again, the difference between politics and reality. Contrary to popular belief, Arabs in general were involved in virtually all aspects of the Holocaust. Perpetrators, bystanders, and protectors of Jews. Perpetrators, bystanders, and protectors of Jews. This did not occur in Europe. This did not occur in Palestine, then governed by the British. This did not principally occur in Syria, which was mostly Free French throughout most of the war. Not even, I would say, in Iraq. And here I put a little asterisk about the issue of the Farhud, which was a terrible, bloody event, one which Hajj Amin and others may have inspired. But just to inject a note of historical accuracy, the Farhud occurred when the British were in control of Baghdad, when there were British troops that were on the outsides of Baghdad and chose not to go in to save, protect the Jewish community or to stop the looting and violence against the Jewish community. The part of the Arab world, if I can use that phrase, where the Holocaust was experienced in every manner but one, that is, no mass extermination, was in North Africa. For 3 years, May 1940 through May 1943, all or part of this territory was governed by fascists. Fascist regime of Pétain in Morocco and Algeria until November 42, Mussolini's Italy governing Libya until early 43, and Tunisia, which was first governed by Vichy until November 42, and then directly by the Germans until May of 1943, the only Arab country to have a full-fledged German occupation. There, that is in North Africa more broadly, the 500,000 Jews of this region suffered discrimination, incarceration, loss of jobs, homes, property, education. They were stripped of citizenship. The 170,000 Jews of Algeria share a unique historical memory with the Jews only of Germany and Austria. These were the only Jews to actually lose their citizenship. They were stateless, totally stateless, as a result of Vichy action. Forced labor, slave labor, thousands sent to camps, torture, and especially unfortunate were those killed. Much of this happened in the more than 110 sites of slave and forced labor that were in Arab countries during the war. Let me just give you a little visual of this.
If you actually look at Casablanca very closely, there's this fantastic scene between Major Strasser and Ilse in which the German tries to convince her to turn her husband in.
It is possible the French authorities will find a reason to put him in the concentration camp here.
The key word being here, in Morocco.
You're saying this only to make me
the go film's out. Most famous scene, the farewell at the airport, also refers to concentration camps.
You have any idea what you'd have to look forward to if you stayed here? 9 chances out of 10, we'd both wind up at a concentration camp. Isn't that true, Louis?
I'm afraid Major Strasser would insist.
Maybe not today. Maybe
the movie came out right in the middle of the war. They had it right.
Many camps, like this internment camp in Morocco, were not built by the Nazis. The pro-fascist Vichy French government had already established dozens of what it called concentration camps in Morocco and Algeria. The Italian fascists built camps in Libya, including one at Jado, where more Jews died than anywhere else in North Africa. With the addition of German camps in Tunisia, there were more than 100 camps in Arab lands.
Some of the worst of the concentration camps of the Second World War were established throughout the Sahara. And in these camps, the utmost severity and barbarity was practiced.
That was Robin McNeil's voice, and sounds much more sonorous than my own. Here's a brief clip of my own visiting what remains of those camps in the Sahara, eastern Morocco. There's also in western Algeria.
In Morocco and Algeria, the Vichy French established scores of slave labor camps. Almost every trace of the camp's existence has disappeared, except here at Tendrara. All that's left of this brutal concentration camp are the crumbling barracks and the abandoned railway track.
This is just one of a network of stops along the line with internment camps at every stop, all the way down the Trans-Sahara, all the way from Morocco through to Algeria.
Jewish prisoners here were mostly from...
Shoot. Sorry about that.
If you actually look at Casablanca very closely, there's this fantastic...
...forward to if you stayed here. Nine chances...
...government had already established...
...some of the worst...
All that's left of this brutal concentration camp are the crumbling barracks and the abandoned railway track.
This is just one of a network of stops along the line with internment camps at every stop, all the way down the Trans-Sahara, all the way from Morocco through to Algeria.
Jewish prisoners here were mostly from Central Europe who had fled from the Nazis to seek refuge in France, only to be deported here. A Vichy propaganda film shows glimpses of forced laborers building the Trans-Sahara Railway. Most were anti-fascist political prisoners. About a third were interned for the crime of being Jewish. 2 hours up the line, on the outskirts of a desolate town called Berghent, there are more ruins. Prisoners called this place Buchenwald in the Sahara.
So this is the railroad station. Not far from here is the labor camp. Jews built this railroad along with other slave laborers. We know this because we have testimonies from Polish Jewish survivors who spoke to British intelligence after liberation.
According to one survivor, the camp commander greeted them with these words.
You all came here to die. You are the scum of Europe. My job is to see that you all die here, and I'm good at what I do.
There were many ways to die. Dysentery, malaria, starvation, no water, bitten by scorpions, bitten by vipers, and you're dead in an hour.
My best friend had to dig his own grave and lie there the whole day without cover. First of all, they smashed one eye, and then they broke his arms, and after a few days, he died.
Now, today we forget what happened to the Jews of Arab lands, but this ironically was not hidden from view 70 years ago. And this is really the sub-theme that I'm trying to underscore, that our historical memory changes. Just like the historical memory of the Temple Mount and what people thought about it 90 years ago, what people think about it today. So too on this issue, and it applies to us as well. So, for example, check out this newsreel that we Americans were watched, newsreel from the Allied victory in Tunisia when Germany was expelled from the African continent in May of 1943.
The Germans' great African war machine collapses. 175,000 surrendered to the Allies in 5 days.
The ordeal of North African Jews was coming to an end.
Hysterically happy crowds hail the British, the French, the Americans as liberators.
A newsreel cameraman captured these images of Tunisian Jews tearing off the detested yellow stars.
Eagerly, a liberated people destroy all reminders of the Nazi occupation.
I mean, they actually wore the yellow star in the middle of Tunisia. And yet that concept, and quite obviously from the film, is extremely little known in collective memory of this era. Just to give you a sense of how committed the Nazis were to extend the Holocaust to Arab lands, we only have to remind ourselves of the story of Tunisia. This was, for several months, the most important front in the European theater. A place where the Nazis never controlled more than a third of the territory. They were bombarded day and night by the Allies, and still, despite this, still Hitler sent the SS, headed by Colonel Walter Rauf, the evil genius who developed the mobile death gas vans in Europe that killed thousands. He sent him to Tunisia to run the SS enterprise there, to begin the process that started with hostage taking, roundups of Jews in the capital, led to their sending to labor camps and the executions of a number of Jews. If the Germans had not been turned back at El Alamein, the long-term goal was to exterminate the Jews first of Tunisia, then of Egypt, and eventually of Palestine too. Now, thankfully, of course, that never happened. Why? Very simple. The war ended in most of North Africa by November 1942, and in the rest of it by May of 1943. Sending Jews across the Mediterranean to be killed in the extermination camps of Europe was a risky and difficult proposition. Though, even despite that, there are examples of the Germans actually using airplanes. They were so committed to killing certain Jews that they flew them from Tunis to Germany. And in this movie, I tell the story of one tragic family sent to Dachau and eventually executed for the desire to be free. Now, against this background, what role did Arabs play? What role did Arabs play in this entire experience? And the answer is every role.
How did Arabs react to the persecution of their Jewish neighbors? As in Europe, most were bystanders, dealing with the daily hardships of war. A few made their hatred heard.
They used to tell us, I remember as long as I live, you Jews, you Yids, you'll all have your throats cut. And they came up with a song in Arabic that went, slap that shovel, meaning work with a shovel. Shalom, that's to designate the Jews.
Some Arabs enlisted in the German army. Others volunteered to guard the labor camps where Jews were incarcerated.
So the largest percentage by far were bystanders.
Obliged to wear the yellow.
The largest percentage by far were bystanders. Bystanders of two sorts. The majority of the bystanders just wanted to survive in tough times. Very difficult times in North Africa during the war. Others played no direct role, but cheered the prosecution. And I have numerous firsthand testimonies from that picture, if you saw, of guys walking down the street, that's the capital of Tunis, being jeered and thrown at bottles and all sorts of things from the buildings above by the local inhabitants. A minority, a regrettably large minority, but a minority, were perpetrators. These were the translators, the guides, the guards. These were the people who made the trains run on time. Without the role of these Arabs, The Germans, French, and Italians would never have been able to go door to door to round up Jews, to operate the camps, or manage confiscated Jewish property. Some were high politicians, others were petty low-level workers, but across the region, in every way, certain numbers of Arabs participated. And then there were the rescuers. Here, I'm not just talking about the ones who showed kindness toward Jews. The number of that in that category is really quite large. I'm talking about Arabs who risked their lives to protect, rescue, or save Jews from persecution or death. In my book, I tell stories of several, principally, though not solely, in Tunisia. And in my film, I tell stories of more. And so I just wanted to do a quick look at this.
And one of the friends of my father, our Arab neighbor, understood that there is a real danger. He took all my family. He took us to his house. And we were there 6 months, or 5 or 6 months.
The Germans opened the door. There were 2-3 Germans with guns. But luckily, there was one Arab called Hassan. He was blocking the door with both hands.
The Germans were beginning to bang on the doors. Our neighbor, her name was Chelbi, she said, "Trust me," she told her. "Amana," in Arabic, that means trust. "Leave her with my kids and don't be afraid."
If I would found that Arab Muslim man that rescued my family, I would kiss him, embrace him, hug him, thank him.
Yeah, the first person you saw was Nassim Zvili. He was the Secretary General of the Labor Party and Israel's ambassador to Paris. And the last one, of course, is the current deputy, a vice prime minister of Minister of Interior, Sylvain Shalom. So all in all, I should say, I believe the percentage of righteous among the Muslims of North Africa was essentially the same as among the Christians of Europe. And think about this for a minute. If after 70 years, Yad Vashem has identified 25,600 righteous to accommodate and to account for the 6 million Jews who were killed in Europe, then I believe for the 4,000 or so Jews killed in North Africa, the percentages of righteous are at least the same and probably higher. Now, why don't we know these stories? Why especially don't we know the stories of rescuers? The reason is twofold. On the one hand, we, the collective we, Jews, Western historians, Israelis, we didn't look very hard. And they, the Arabs, they didn't want to be found. So let me tell you one story, and you will see how, in the end, this all connects to the Temple Mount Haram al-Sharif issue that triggered this from the beginning. This is Si Ali Sakat. Si Ali Sakat was the mayor of Tunis in the 1930s. He retired to a country home in the Zaghouan Valley, which is a beautiful place, about 35 miles, I think, outside of Tunis. It just happened that the Zaghouan Valley was right on the battle line where the Allies and the Germans were having some of the worst fighting of the war. About a half a mile away from his farm, I visited his farm, I visited these sites, about a half a mile away from his property was a German labor camp. About 60 or so Jewish men were there, had been taken there in January of 1943, and by the time of this fighting, which is a couple months later, they are stuck right in the middle of the fighting, about a half a mile away from his home. Fighting is raging all around them. They escape, and they go to the closest walled piece of property, which is his house, and they start banging on the large doors of his house. I mean, it's a big hacienda. It's like a walled compound. They start banging on the walled compound. He comes to the door. He has to decide what to do. There are these 60 guys outside in the middle of fighting. He doesn't know who's going to win the war. Germans aren't doing so bad. He has to decide, do I let them in or do I keep them out? C.I. Sakat makes a very quick decision. He lets them all in. He gives them food, gives them shelter. They stay on his farm for the balance of the fighting. And how do we know all this? We know this because there are books, testimonies written by the Tunisian Jewish community, which thank Siali Sakat for opening up his gates and letting in 60 Jewish survivors, 60 Jewish slave labor inmates. But why don't we know the story? We don't know the story because something happened. So I go and I interview Siali Sakat's children and grandchildren, and I show them the evidence. I show them the written stories written about their father and grandfather. And their response to me was, you know, this is all very interesting. This is fascinating. But this isn't the story we tell in our family. We do have a family story about our father and grandfather being generous and hospitable. But it's not letting in Jews. The story we tell in our family is that my father and grandfather let in German POWs who were escaping from an Allied POW camp just after the war. Think about what happened. There is absolutely zero evidence that German POWs made their way to Siali Sakat's farm. And there is testimonies and evidence from the day that Jews made their way and he let them in. Something happened in the 50s, 60s, 70s. The exact same thing that happened to the perception of Solomon's Temple being on top of Al-Aqsa Mosque. That politics intruded on history. Siali Sakat understood what was going on, just the same way as back in 1924. They understood exactly what was going on. But something affected the generation of the sons and the grandsons. And that is what we are inheriting today, which is the fact that politics has intruded on history. Politics is corrupting history, and politics is the solution, in fact, in the end, for all this. The message that Mohammed brought you, and that the one that Mohammed and I wrote about in this op-ed, was what is the fundamental difference, among many others, between the Nakba and the Holocaust? At the very core, the Holocaust was not a political act. The Holocaust was not something that could be solved by Nazi-Jewish negotiation. At the core, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is ultimately a political event, tragedy though there may be, and it will ultimately be solved by the reinjection of the right type of politics. So what we have seen in this story and what we have seen in the skewing of history in the Al-Aqsa case is the wrong type of politics injecting itself and aborting what history's lessons really are. Thank you very much. So I'm sure that you have lots of questions for Mohammed, maybe one or two for myself. The floor is open to all of you. Yes, Dan.
Thanks for the presentation.
There's a microphone right there.
Dan Raviv with CBS. Mohammed, yeah, I am thinking about you. I'm wondering whether in any way you're being too kind to what is happening in the territories that Israel captured in 67. I'll speak with a blunter language of critics of Israel. You're giving the occupation a pass, that you've tried to tell Palestinian students that it's not as bad as the Holocaust, but is it still bad? Is there still something that needs to be condemned worldwide as it is? Israel gets a lot of criticism. It may be exaggerated, but where's your perspective on where it should be when Palestinians feel that that you are fighting for your own independent sovereign country? Don't you have to be angry, brave, active? I'm sure a lot of people think they have to be violent.
Actually, when the students went back and then there was this uproar, the response was that visiting Auschwitz and witnessing the suffering of the other did not make us less nationalistic, but made us more humanistic. And so I believe that in showing empathy for the suffering of the other and in trying to also have the other express empathy for your own suffering, we can meet in the middle, in the sense that for someone in Tel Aviv looking at the Palestinian society and seeing all this rhetoric of hate, enmity, and extremism, he will have no tendency to really move on to support peace and reconciliation. Similar in Palestine. So our work is more focused on bridging this, on looking at the good, yani, because I feel like what happened to me, that the good in the other opened my heart for talking to the other, for the other. And the evil in the other, or in me, actually brings in the evil in us. And that's why I wrote a post in saying that if Netanyahu would have said what Rob was talking about, the Holocaust, he would have much better received than trying to stigmatize a whole people by what a fanatic, radical, extremist Palestinian leader did take. I think part of what I'm doing is I'm looking at my own and trying to assess critically my history, because there is so much mythologies and untrue and misperceptions. And unless I do that, we cannot reach peace. That's why I think we can bridge the clashing narratives by trying to build a bridge narrative. You don't have to believe in my narrative. I don't have to believe in your narrative, but at least we have to respect each other's narrative. And so in this way, I cannot deny that the Jews do not have any attachment to Palestine or to Jerusalem. And you cannot deny that I live there and I exist there. So I think it is a soft approach, yet it doesn't appeal to the masses. And in this way, we hope that eventually rationality will rule, that it will come back.
Thank you. Yes, I'm sorry, I don't know your name. Nicole.
Thank you. Mr. Dajani, you touched on this briefly when you answered the previous question, but you talked about how the impact on the students while you were in Auschwitz and how it changed a lot of their perspectives. But once they were once again immersed in the conflict and the occupation, did this perspective persist, or did you see that the politics once again affected their perception of the narrative?
Actually, it is like walking out of the cave of the Plato's allegory of the cave. They walk out and they see the truth. Then they come back and they want to tell the truth to their to the other prisoners in the cave. And then the community rejects that, and even rejects it because in the Palestinian Holocaust narrative, there is a lot of denial in order not to link, like in also in the Jewish Nakba, yani many of them were greeted back and say, and they asked me that. They said, why do we have to learn about the Holocaust when Israelis make illegal learning about the Nakba? And so I said, it's not a matter of bartering, because we, as Middle Easterners, we always think in terms of bartering. Give me this, I'll give you that. And I said, it's a matter of doing the right thing. And in this way, you are learning about this because, historically speaking, it is historically wrong, morally wrong, to deny the Holocaust. And they have actually a tough battle within their community, but many of them expressed actually in their post, and one student wrote an article in The Atlantic defending the trip. Another student wrote in the Al-Quds newspaper, also explained defending the trip. So basically, I think there is change. I read the other day that a school took their students to Yad Vashem. And so I think we need time, but the conflict and statements like Netanyahu's statement does not help, or all the other officials who deny the rights of Palestinians, the attitude of the Palestinians to deny the rights of Jews. But if we acknowledge the rights of Palestinians and Palestinians acknowledge the rights of Jews, then I think this is part of the solution rather than part of the problem.
Yeah, please.
Albert and Kemkin. Mr. Satloff, I just wonder if you could tell us, has your book Among the Righteous been translated into Hebrew and incorporated into Israeli educational curriculum?
I was quite honored that Yad Vashem translated my book and published it in Yad Vashem official publications. Whether it exists in various curricula, I really don't follow it. So that, you know, it was a very satisfying validation of the work. And then the movie, the book's been translated into multiple languages, Arabic, Spanish, others. And the movie itself has appeared in Arabic and French and German. Yes, Dick.
Dr. Dajani again, thanks.
You're obviously a courageous man.
I just wanted to get from you, I'm Dan Pollack from the Zionist Organization of America. I just wanted to get from you the kind of the best case interpretation. So you're obviously a courageous man. You're obviously still on the fringe of Palestinian thought, though, as your own narrative tells us. Eventually, you can hope to become more mainstream. But what happens with the extreme on the other side, the people who are influencing people to knife people in the streets of Jerusalem? Do you actually have a hope that someday in the Palestinian body politic, they will be considered such outliers that the community will restrain their being?
Do you have any hope of this down the future?
Actually, I do, and that's why I'm an optimist, because, like I said, those who are focusing on the past and the present cannot see the future. And I look to the future and I see the future. I see a future of peace and reconciliation. And in this way, I feel that the dominant paradigm within Israel, within the Israeli community and within the Palestinian community is people want normal lives. People want to live normally, want to live in peace. And notice every time the opportunity is, there is a lot of cooperation. And I think that the message of peace is not heard. Yet, in my view, it is dominant. And for instance, people, when we started the Wasatia movement, they said there is no Wasatia in Islam. Yet when we had our yearly conferences, we had more than 200 sheikhs coming in and talking about moderation and reconciliation and charity. And so in this way, I feel there is, in both societies, there are the majority, the silent majority, who if we let free or we allow, because they are captured by a vocal, violent minority. And so people are afraid to speak out. And in this way, what we are missing in this conflict are leaders. If we would have had a Nelson Mandela, a Martin Luther King, a Gandhi, then I think we'd have reached peace. But we don't have leaders, and leaders, instead of leading the people, they are following the people. And so in this way, and they are following the people, in Israel, there is a lot of fear, insecurity of the other, that the other is cheating, the other is lying, the other do not believe in peace. And the same feeling is within the Palestinian society. So our message is to try to change this perception of the other.
Gaith, in the middle here.
Hi, Gaith Al-Omari from the Washington Institute. If I may, two short comments. One, I want to echo what Dan just mentioned. I mean, Mohammed, you're too modest. What you did was extremely courageous, what you had to face. was very difficult, and that's something that I think is worth noting. My second comment is actually follows from your last comment. What I found shocking and shameful is that as this was happening to you, we had no reaction from the Palestinian leadership to give some legitimacy to what you did. It falls into this whole trend that we have seen of anti-normalization, whereby people like yourself and others who want to engage with Israelis, understand the Israeli narrative, engage with Jews, are actually victimized and actually made to pay a price. So if I may suggest that this is not something, or if I may add, it's not something that was only shocking what I saw from the lack of Palestinian reaction, but was also shocking. There was no reaction from our government here. To the best of my knowledge, the issue of anti-normalization was never raised publicly by Secretary Kerry when he was engaging President Abbas, nor privately, as far as I know. So if I may suggest that this is something that we should pay attention to. This should become part of US policy as we engage the region. Yes, it's very difficult right now to get the President Abbas to concede on Jerusalem or refugees or all these big issues, but it shouldn't be that hard for us to press him to give a political cover to people like yourself who want to engage in this thing and to want to get an understanding of the narrative and of the story and of the other side. Thank you.
I think it's a very important point. I mean, I don't follow the details at the moment, but I'm pretty sure that there's a Fatah prohibition now on actually there's a PA prohibition on initiatives between institutions, between Israeli and Palestinian institutions, which, when you think about it, is otherworldly, crazy.
Which is actually. We have leaders who give double messages, whether on both sides. And so here, Abbas meets as Jewish leaders and tell them that the Holocaust is the most heinous crime. And yet, he never made any effort, really, to meet with the students and to tell them what you did is courageous, and so to send that message to the Palestinian society. So what they are interested in, there are two messages there. To the world, we are moderates, but to the Palestinians and to the Israel, there is no normalization. Anyway, it's against norm. This is what the student unions wrote. Nine students union made a communique about the trip at Al-Quds University, and the headline was "Normalization equals treason." Treason, and so. And Fatah was one of the main signers of that. And so here, this is the double messages. You have to tell your people the same message you are telling abroad.
Okay. Last question, Ralph.
Thank you for an excellent both presentations. Ralph Nuremberger, Georgetown University. Rob, most of the Israelis, articles that I've seen since Netanyahu's comments have pointed out that he was wrong. But the Israeli right somehow has taken this and has tried to prove that he was right, thanking Netanyahu for making this comment. I read an article saying that the Grand Mufti was part of Hitler's inner circle. Why are they seeking to distort history? I think I know the answer, but it would at least worth some comment.
Well, look, I don't know what goes on inside people's minds. I do know that I have seen some articles, that suggest that, yes, while it was true that that the Prime Minister exaggerated, he made an important contribution by reminding us about the role that the Mufti did play and the virulently anti-Semitic legacy that the Mufti had. And I assume the implication is to try to ascribe to political leaders today the direct inheritance of that of the Mufti's ideology. I think that there's like a lot of things, there's obviously a germ of truth in this. The Mufti was a virulent anti-Semite. The Mufti did bequeath to a certain strain of this virulently anti-Jewish element, which regrettably one can find in aspects of Palestinian and wider Arab and Muslim politics. I do think it's also a grave mistake on the part when you put it in the both analytically and politically. It's a grave mistake analytically to ascribe this generally to Palestinian politics, because it ascribes a it takes a political contest and turns it something immeasurably worse, immeasurably more difficult to resolve. And prescriptively, because frankly, when all is said and done, Israelis and Palestinians are fated to live next to each other. And the solutions, I keep coming back to, this is ultimately a political solution. And if one denies the power of politics, and one actually distorts politics to deny the power of politics to resolve it, then we're exponentially worse off than where we are. So on both, you know, historical grounds and political grounds, it's not in my view the wisest path for this to follow.
But actually, what is missing in this jigsaw puzzle is that people do not realize that the Mufti does not represent the Palestinian people. He was not even their leader. He was imposed on them by the British mandate. The British were the ones who appointed him as a Mufti when Al-Khalidi deserved it more than he did, because he knew nothing about religion. He was a young. So basically, I don't see any in trying to stigmatize Al-Mufti, that how does that affect us? And this is where it shouldn't affect us as Palestinians, because he doesn't represent us. And if there is a fascist among us, okay, that's deal with him as an individual, not as a representative of the people. And actually, when I read the first time the statement by Netanyahu, I wrote, I wish there was an Ed Morrow to stand up to him. But I was very glad later that there were more than 100 Ed Morrows that stood up to him. Most of them were Jews. And I think that carried more significance in that message. So that's I think that's a bright side of the story. Thank you.
Friends, thank you very much. You know, for an event like this, to draw a wonderful group like you is really very inspiring. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much. Thank you.